A society's culture reflects the environment in which people live. In fact, many cultural traditions provide informal solutions when formal laws or policies are absent. This suggests that as societies modernize and adopt new policies, long-standing cultural traditions may change as well. This paper studies the causal relationship between policy and culture in the context of matrilocality and patrilocality. These practices determine whether daughters or sons live with their parents after marriage and have persisted for centuries among many ethnic groups. Can modern policies weaken these customs? And if so, what are the consequences? To help frame the analysis, consider two potential effects of matri and patrilocality. First, they can provide a form of informal insurance by designating which child will care for parents in their old age. This means that the introduction of formal savings mechanisms may crowd out these traditions. Second, matri and patrilocality may affect parental investments in education. By linking parents' future well-being more directly to their children's labor and marriage market outcomes, these practices provide parents with additional incentive to invest in their children's education. This suggests that policies that weaken these cultural practices may additionally affect educational investment. The author evaluates these dynamics in Indonesia. This figure shows there is substantial geographic variation in the district-level percent of individuals who belong to traditionally matrilocal ethnic groups. Belonging to a traditional matrilocal ethnicity is predictive of modern behavior, that is, of observing a married daughter living in the same household as her parents, and matrilocality is related to differences in female education rates. Compared to females in non-matrilocal households, those in matrilocal households are 1 to 2 percentage points more likely to be enrolled in school on a yearly basis relative to their brothers. When summed over the 18 years a child could be enrolled in school, this amounts to a gap of 0.14 to 0.38 years of schooling between matrilocal and non-matrilocal females, again, relative to their brothers. So, what happens when policy weakens the incentives for matrilocality? The paper focuses on the 1977 introduction of a formal source of old age support, a pension system. Eligible employees deposited a percentage of their earnings, along with an employer-matched contribution, in an interest-earning account throughout their working lives, and received the benefits in lump sum form upon retirement. Crucially, the program's coverage expanded gradually over time. This allows the author to estimate its causal impact using variation in program exposure. Specifically, she uses three types of variation. First is age. Daughters who were sufficiently old when the pension plan was introduced are less likely to have been affected as parental investments in them had already been made. Second, there is geographic variation as households living in areas with more pension program offices, liaisons, and representatives were more likely to be enrolled. Finally, the key question is the differential effect of the pension plan on matrilocal households. Thus, the author compares matrilocal versus non-matrilocal ethnic groups. And she finds that the introduction of the pension plan reduced both the practice of matrilocality and educational investments in women. These figures show the differential effects on matrilocal females of being born in a province with high exposure to the pension plan. Each point corresponds to a particular 3-year birth cohort. So, for example, these are the differential effects of the pension plan when estimated among women born between 1969 and 1971. These women were between the ages of 6 and 8 when the plan was introduced. To the left are cohorts who were older, and to the right are cohorts who were younger. For both outcomes, daughters who were older when the program was introduced are essentially unaffected. This is consistent with the idea that parental investments in these children had already been made. But for younger cohorts, the pension program reduced both educational investment and the likelihood of practicing matrilocality as adults. Notably, the educational attainment of sons in matrilocal households was unaffected. These dynamics also generalize beyond the specific case of Indonesia. In an additional analysis, the author studies the 1972 introduction of a pension plan in Ghana, a country where patrilocality, rather than matrilocality, has traditionally been more prevalent. Despite the substantial differences between these countries and settings, the cultural repercussions of the policy change are similar. In Ghana, sons in traditionally patrilocal groups who were young enough to be exposed to the pension plan experience a decline in both educational investment and the probability of practicing patrilocality as adults. Thus, modern policy changes can disrupt long-standing cultural traditions. In this setting, the introduction of pension plans reduced the practice of matra and patrilocality, and, in the process, reduced educational investment. This illustrates how formal old-age support policies can crowd out family and kinship traditions, and, more broadly, demonstrates that culture mediates both the intended and unintended effects of policy. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. These include papers on the evolution of cultural practices and attitudes, those studying the role of family ties in determining economic outcomes, and finally, research on the interaction between culture and policy.